skies all open wide, geese go high and over. Oh, now you're a beachcomber, fistful of samphire, sea lavender. See ya next year.
I am chatting to Rich. This is a one-off sort of special podcast episode for the Deepdale podcast. We're just chatting really about Man the Lifeboats, who are performing on Saturday at Deepdale on the Brick Barn stage that many of you will have seen them perform on before and absolutely loved. They did a brilliant opening set to the 2021 festival, and they've been to us previously. We're very honoured to be on the Soul of Albion sort of launch tour, the new album tour. And so it's going to be great having the guys back in the Brick Barn, and there'll be a lot of dancing. There'll be some great beer. And yeah, it's going to be lovely to have the guys. How are you, man? How is life? How is the music industry?
Very good. Thank you. Life is good. The boys are good. The band's doing well. The album's out and that's doing well. Music industry is maybe not so, it's a challenging place at any time, but our little niche in it, number 27 on the official folk charts, we're very happy with that. So yeah, no, we're very well.
That's cool. Excellent.
And very, excellent. Very, very much looking forward to coming back to Deepdale on Saturday, because there are some places you play and love and just want to go back year after year. And you know, that's not always possible to do it every year, but Deepdale is definitely up there at the top of the list.
That's lovely to hear. Thank you so much. Well, that's Chris loves putting on live music, as you know, and and is very excited about all the gigs he puts on. But when people he describes as good friends want to come and play, it's lovely, yeah. Really. So it's fantastic to have you. Yeah. So how is Soul of Albion kind of come about? You know, was it something that kind of began during lockdowns, or was it something that was mulling around in your head for a long time?
I'll be honest. It started. I don't know if it didn't really come about as a fully formed idea, as things very rarely do, especially in a band. But the first songs were kind of written in 20. Around the time we were recording the first album, so 2017, 2018, some of them just after Brexit, some of them a bit after that. And I kind of realized when I took them to the boys and we started playing around with different ideas and instrumentation, that there were some themes in there, but it still didn't really come together until we recorded it, really.
Yeah.
So we planned to go in to a studio pre-lockdown or before COVID even happened, but we kind of delayed and we took a bit of time working with the producer. The producer's a great friend of mine, Jamie Evans. His dad was my first guitar teacher when I was 16. We went to school together. He left and traveled the world, played in bands, and now he's an established producer. And yeah, we hooked up again when we were kind of 39, 40 and started recording a solo, first of all, my solo album and then the band album. So we did quite a bit of pre-production work with Jamie, and then we booked Rockfield Studios in Wales, where Queen and Oasis and Bellowhead, Eliza Carthy.
A little Black bit of history Sabbath, in those buildings.
Yeah, goodness me, it's incredible. And it's just a farm, you know, it's just a working dairy farm And they're very, very proud that it is still a working dairy farm. You know, you get introduced to the horses and the cows and the tractors still there on site. So we booked Rockfield and then COVID happened. So that had to be postponed twice, three times, I think. Because either someone had COVID or there were restrictions in Wales that meant we couldn't go there. So it took a year longer to record than it probably should have done. And the whole Soul of Albion theme, by then it was coming apparent that the songs did have a theme, you know, a national identity. What do these islands mean to us at this stage? What's going on? And then I think the final idea was from a friend of mine, Colin. And he's a friend of the band. He comes to a lot of gigs. He's a wonderful man. He started, I think he was on like a one-man mission to explore the literature, the arts, the culture of Albion and to find out what it means. So it came from one song. I stole it, basically. I think that's what I'm trying to say.
A long circuitous route via Bohemian Rhapsody and various other things to admit that you stole the idea.
Nicked it completely. but it came together. The song Soul of Albion came together. We were playing around with the idea and the riff and the lyrics, and we walked into Rockfield and the Coach House studio. The piano that Oasis recorded Don't Look Back in Anger on was just sitting there in this lovely little studio, and David played a few chords on it and it sounded just phenomenal. So we changed the whole song to be a piano, a ballad instead of a kind of an upbeat reggae song, which is what it was before. Jamie left me and David just to play through the song on our own in the studio, and he pressed record and they all walked out. And I think the final version you hear is take four. But we left everything in. We left all the cracks and creaks of the piano and the room, and it was a magical experience recording that song. Brilliant. So, yeah, brilliant. I hope people are enjoying it. It's long. It's 7 minutes of not very upbeat musings on the nation and everything else. But it's something we're proud of. So, I hope people enjoy it.
Oh, it's a beautiful album. It really is. And it's going to be fantastic to see you performing it live. And I understand there's going to be sort of like two halves. There's going to be the older songs. So I'm looking forward to Doomed being played, as it's probably my favorite track. And then you're going to do the new stuff with the Soul of Albion. So it's going to be a really, really enjoyable gig. I think it's going to be just lovely having you back in that Brick Barn.
Yeah. And the Brick Barn, I don't know what it is about it. The sound's great. It sounds great for the band as well. The sound's great on stage. The audience is always just brilliant, up for it. And I don't know. There's always something unexpected or a nice bit of banter or something funny that happens that adds to the atmosphere. But now we're looking forward to playing the new stuff. But I think splitting it into two halves and doing all the old stuff is how it's been working for us. That's great.
Yeah. And it's lovely that you recorded it on a working farm and you're coming to a working farm to play on the tour, which is fantastic. So we really like that linkage. That's really good. So yeah. Tell me a bit more about like the Man the Lifeboats itself. Kind of how did you come about? Have you been friends for a very long time? You know, how did it sort of form?
So I went to see a gig in London with a friend of mine at the Garage in Islington. Skinny Lister were playing, and I think I didn't really know about them. I saw a clip online of a double bassist crowd surfing and a accordion player who just looked absolutely crazed and thought, and the song is Six Whiskies. I thought, I have to go and see them live. So I went to see them and they blew me away. Next day I went online and put up adverts, right, forming a folk band, anyone want to join? And the next day, someone got back to me, a guy called Harvey, and he'd been at the same gig and he wanted to do the same thing, start a band. So he stayed, he was in the band for a couple of years. Then Sam the bassist joined, Dan the fiddle joined. It was mostly done through a few musician dating sites. So the musician's equivalent of Tinder, yeah. we didn't know each other before then. And then we met David the drummer, and he was in the studio kind of 2 days later recording the first EP with us. And then Harvey left the next January, and we met Aaron, and Aaron was in the studio the next week recording the first album. So it's been a stable lineup since 2018 now. The beginning of 2019, I think. So yeah, no, and we get on really well. Five good friends. We did think about possibly adding more people, but the logistics of a sixth or seventh or eighth, it just gets, we'll be fine as we are, I think, for the moment.
It is wonderful welcoming larger bands to Deepdale for things like the festival and stuff, and like Pavey Arc were, a huge number. But yeah, just occasionally you think, oh my word, how do you manage to get all of these people in the same place for anything? From, rehearsals to performances, just, logistical, absolute nightmare. So,
I remember seeing, I saw Eliza Carthy and the Wayward Band at Bearded Theory a while ago, and there were about, 15 of them on stage, and how she got that many, and they sounded phenomenal. It's a bit like Bellowhead, really. Bellowhead, there's 9, 10, 11 of them at any stage. And every time I saw Bellowhead live, they were just phenomenal. Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. Excellent. And how's the tour gone so far? I hear the launch event in the boat was a fascinating experience. Chris absolutely loved it, and so did his mates. So, that sounded like a really interesting thing.
It was an interesting thing. It was a brilliant night. And one of the great parts of it was surprises. Like, I didn't expect to see Chris there, so that was great. My old band manager turned up unannounced from 10 or 15 years ago, and it was a sellout. We sold out a medieval galleon, which is nice to say.
There's not many gigs in a medieval galleon, are there? I think that's fantastic. We're quite proud of an old kind of, almost probably 16th, 17th century barn, but a medieval galleon, hats off to it. Yeah, that's a whole different level of gig.
It was quite hard logistically because they're not set up for full band gigs, really. And it's a tiny space down at the bottom of the hold. And you do open the ceiling up, so there's another kind of level. But we were, there were audience members. I don't want to say I was spitting on them, but I might have been. They were very, very close anyway. And I think the atmosphere was so good because it was a smaller 70, 80 people. And some dear friends, some of our patrons, because we're now on Patreon. I don't know if you heard of it, a subscriber website, which started in COVID, and which means that people can contribute a subscription amount every month, and they can pay as little or as much as they like, really. And they get access to all sorts of behind the scenes photos, music videos, kind of recordings of songs when they. So they've all seen the album develop. So to have the patrons at the album launch was great as well, those who could come. It was a long day setting it all up and playing this full-on gig, but it was brilliant to get it out and a really good atmosphere. The tour's going okay so far. We've only done actually one gig and the album launch. We played in Bath last week. And had a really good crowd at the Chapel Arts Centre, which is an old converted kind of church building. But that was a great night. This weekend, we're going from Falmouth in Cornwall on Friday up to you guys on Saturday.
So no distance at all then, like next door?
Just around the corner.
Yeah.
the weekend after, we've got a couple of sold out gigs in Yorkshire and Newcastle, and then we're back in the south for Reading, Winchester, London. So going well, and tickets in most places are going well. We were worried that people might not want to come out given the current climate and so on, but most places the tickets are going really, really well. So cool. We're grateful for that. Yeah.
Well, I hope Falmouth goes really well. I and that the journey to Deepdale is uneventful, which is probably the best I can offer you from Falmouth to Norfolk. But we are really, really looking forward to seeing you on Saturday night. It's going to be brilliant. And we've got a lot of people coming, and it's going to be a great evening. So if I played one of your tracks to sort of finish this off, what would you select? Which one would you like me to play?
The one that's getting most play, I reckon, online, the one that people seem to be going back to is Born Drunk. Cool. If you want something a little bit different, you could go for Stourbridge Fair. Which is not about Stourbridge at all. It's actually
of course, logically, yeah.
Logically. It's there was a huge medieval kind of gathering affair up in Cambridgeshire, on the River Stour in Cambridgeshire. And it was, the Glastonbury of its day. Isaac Newton used to go there, just absolute carnage. And I saw a documentary on it, wrote a song about it. It was a BBC Four documentary online. So that sounds like an amazing thing to have a folk song written about. And I can't find the documentary anywhere. I'm wondering if I just dreamt it. But there is a Wikipedia page confirming that there was a big Stourbridge Fair. So, yeah, and that when we play that live, that's going down really, really well.
Cool. Excellent. Well, as I say, really looking forward to you. If anybody is still wanting to come and see these lovely guys, then there are still some day tickets available, just so you know, like evening tickets available at £10 a head, or there is a little bit of accommodation left at Deepdale if you want to combine it with a visit to the beautiful North Norfolk coast, which fits their music so beautifully. And a band of the time. The lyrics are superb. You cover the interesting times that we live in. Fabulously. Yeah, we could use other words. I'm going to go for the polite one. And
was it yesterday? And the headline on the top of the paper was UN Secretary General says we're all doomed. That's my line.
Yeah, he obviously has been listening to your music. Clearly, exactly. Has been listening to your music. So Well, thanks for chatting to me, Rich. Really superb, and we'll see you in a few days' time.
Yeah, looking forward to it.
They gathered for a show. There were gypsies from the marshes and fairies from the moor, artisans and farmhands, the rich folk and the poor. Well, if you had the money, you could buy most anything. From all corners of existence, they came and bartering. And for the penniless, the homeless, the aged and the ill, you'd better go off thieving so you could get your fill. Welcome to the center of the universe, my dear. There's fire in the heavens and carnage in the air. And it's time to reap and sow. The orchard is a heaving where the lovers, don't you know? They're smoking pipes of peace and chasing dragons on the heath. And in the parish of St. Mary, they wear nothing underneath. Well, it's not Saturnalia, it's a solid number two. Take this prism, Mr. Newton, you won't believe what it can do. But I've no use for trinkets, ornaments or silk, as the parson pours a whiskey.
Thanks for listening to this special episode of the Deepdale Podcast in November 2022 with Rich from the band Man the Lifeboats. We're really looking forward to hosting the gents this Saturday night, the 12th of November, with Adam Clark in support. They'll be playing in the Brick Barn at Deepdale Camping and Rooms, our music venue on the beautiful North Norfolk coast. There are a few tickets available and a little accommodation on our campsite and in our rooms. We hope you'll join us. For more information, head to deepdalemusic.co.uk. Oh, and please do subscribe to the Deepdale Podcast on any good podcast app or directory. Thanks for listening. Bye.
Skies all open wide, geese go high and over. Oh, now you're a beachcomber, fistful of samphire, sea lavender, see ya next year.